Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Good morning. I want to welcome everyone out to Leatherwood Church this morning. We are glad that you're here, despite all of the fears and all of the coughings. I will say we do offer our coronavirus section up front here. We have been very proactive. If you would like to self-distance from your neighbor, there are plenty of good seats up front and nobody will be around you. But I just want to start with our call to worship. I've never seen so much fear in my life. And I've never seen so much paranoia over something we don't even know or understand yet. And so I got to thinking about this. You know, when God is up to something, the devil always tries to fight back. We've seen this ourselves. We had an excellent snow camp. We had 66 people go forward to receive salvation at snow camp. We had 66 people go forward to receive salvation at snow camp. That's awesome. God was moving and working in the lives of the young people. And I've also never seen so much resistance and so much attacks of the enemy since we've gotten back from snow camp and even before we left to go to snow camp. It was almost darn near impossible to get there this year. And it's been even worse since we got back. But God is up to something, and the devil always tries to distract from what God is doing. And this is no different. How do I know that this is from the devil? Well, number one, what's the biggest thing that it is doing to people? It is making them afraid. The Word of God says, "For God did not give us a spirit of fear or timidity, but a spirit of power, of love, and of a sound mind." God always brings a sound mind, and He always brings power, and He always brings love. So this isn't from God. What's the other thing that this thing is doing? It's isolating people. You see, it says in Peter that the devil prowls around like a roaring lion, waiting to seek who he can devour. And so the devil is trying to break up the church and trying to get you isolated so that he can attack. Why? I don't know, but God is up to something. Otherwise, this wouldn't be happening. You know, I came across, I want to bring up the first picture. And if you can read that, just a couple of weeks ago, actually just the weekend before we were at snow camp, this happened in Tennessee. It says, "Waves of repentance and revival occurring in Tennessee." I'm going to bring up the next one. It absolutely could inspire another great awakening. "Awakened Tennessee reports revival across the state." Also, just got sent this video last night by this gentleman. He used to be a youth leader in our area. Now he's in Florida. But he sent me this video about his youth group and being just completely overwhelmed by the Holy Spirit of God last night. You know, what is going on here is these kids were supposed to go to like a snow camp retreat that got canceled. And so instead they just decided they were going to rent a cabin and just meet there and seek the Lord. And he said that God showed up in a big way. They started their worship service last night at 10 p.m. and didn't end until 1 a.m. God is up to something. God is up to something. 2 Chronicles. And this is the verse that I preached on my first Sunday here as pastor. It says, "When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. That's funny, isn't it? When you look back at those churches in Tennessee, all of them are saying two things are happening. That people are repenting and people are praying. People are repenting and people are praying, and God is showing up in a mighty way. And so today, we're here to have church. We're not supposed to have church today, but we're here to have church. I've been advised against it by mayors, by politicians, by random strangers sending me threats over the internet to tell me that, you know, I'm disobeying the governor's orders. Bring it. We're here for revival. We're here to meet with God. And the president has called for a day of prayer today. So we're going to be spending some time in prayer. We're going to be spending some time worshiping. We may have a sermon, I don't know. But we're going to let the Lord lead us and guide us today. I will tell you that at any time during the service today, at any point, the altars are open here for you to come and receive prayer, whether it be for healing, whether it be seeking the Lord, whether it be just asking Him and repenting your sins, asking for forgiveness, whatever that may be, they are open today. And we are here to meet with God. Because you know what? It's in my estimation, there are two options that we're faced with as a nation, as a world. We can either repent and receive revival, or the Lord's coming back. It will be His return. I'm praying for revival. And I hope that you'll pray with me. Lord, we come to you today. Lord, we are not afraid. Because you are our God. You are our Lord. You are our King. Your word says that you hem us in before and behind. And Lord, we want to seek your protection and your face today. Lord, we are sorry for the things that we may have done wrong, but Lord, we are here to worship you, to lift you up, to bring you glory. And Lord, may we be a beacon and a light to those in our community to show them the way. Lord, the way is not through fear and isolation, but the Lord, the way is through your word and your mighty hand. Lead us today, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Let's stand and worship this.
Wonderful power in the blood. sing it loud, now you watch in the night.
The glory of God is the manifest beauty of His holiness. It's the going public of His holiness. It's the way He puts His holiness on display for people to apprehend. The heavens are telling the glory of God. What does that mean? It means He's shouting at us. He shouts with clouds. He shouts with blue expanse. He shouts with gold on the horizons. He shouts with galaxies and stars. He's shouting, "I am glorious. Open your eyes." Do you see it? Do you love it? You were made for this. I'm made for this. This is why I exist, to see that. Everything is pointing to that. All the glory that I thought was so attractive is going there. This is all husks and ashes. Now we see through a glass darkly, then face to face. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed to us. So the glory that's coming is of such an all-satisfying, infinitely beautiful, totally need-meeting and joy-producing kind. 80 years of pain will be as nothing. This light, momentary affliction is working for us an eternal way of what? Glory!
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of His glory.
God is aiming that we see and treasure His glory, the riches of His glory. So I ask, do you see it? Do you love it? And I'll say again, you were made for this.
It's good. God's got something else.
Bring him. We're going to have our time of prayer and prayer testimony right now. Doug and I discussed, instead of doing it an individual testimony, we thought, hey, we were thinking let's use this as a time of prayer. We will open this opportunity up for others to come forward and pray if they would feel led to pray for us as a church and for the whole situation that's going on. But the one word that Doug kept discussing in the opening was the idea of fear being rampant, that people are afraid, they're unsure. But in Proverbs, we learn that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Proverbs 3:7 tells us, be not wise in your own eyes, fear the Lord, and turn away from evil. If you watched that last video, what did that video teach us? That everything is created, and that we were created for what purpose? To glorify God. That is why you're here today. That is why you exist every single day, is to glorify God. Now, if you want a testimony in this world, how do you react to situations like this as a believer? How do you live your daily life right now in the situation we're in, with all the chaos and the concern and the unknown? How are you holding yourself today? That is your testimony to the world. But we are Christ's children, and we are called to glorify Him. And that's what we will do. So I'm going to open with prayer. And then if there's anybody else that would like to come up and pray over the church, to pray for the fears of this nation, to pray for revival, we will definitely open the mic up for that, and we would appreciate that. So let's go in prayer now. Dear Father, we know that you are the only thing we should fear, Lord. That all of our attention, all of our reverence, all of our concern, Lord, should be given to you first. Lord, and then you will guide us how we direct our paths, Lord, how we make choices each day, Lord, how we live our lives. That if we put you first, Lord, that if we come to you before all else, before anyone else or anything else, Lord, that you will direct our paths, you will guide us in your path of righteousness, Lord, and we seek that today. Lord, here at Leatherwood, we seek that you guide us in a path of righteousness, Lord. That you will open our minds by your Spirit, our hearts by your Spirit, Lord, and show us the path that will bring you glory. Lord, help us to walk in that. Strengthen us. Give us the will and desire to do that. Lord, and for all those that aren't here today, Lord, whether it's because of sickness or concern or fear, Lord, we ask that you bring healing to them. Bring peace. Lord, bring comfort. And Lord, help those of us that are comforted by you to, as your word says, take that comfort and go and comfort others. Lord, this is a time when you desire to move. Lord, your word teaches us that for those that love you, that you work all things together for good, for those that are called according to your purpose. Lord, help us to see that and to know, Lord, that you have good plans in this. And that there are people out there, Lord, that are blind to your truth right now. And this is a moment where we can go and we can be the voice of Christ. We can be his hands and his feet in this world. Strengthen us to not have fear of people, or fear of the situation, or fear of what the media is teaching us, Lord. Help us to fear only you, to have a fear of the Lord. Lord, we can be a people that can be part of your revival. Lord, we just ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Father, I thank you. I know you are here with us right now, Lord, ministering to each heart that's here. Father, I thank you, Lord, that your love is just so extraordinary, Lord. Father, your grace is so abounding, Lord. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you Lord, you want us to just trust you, Lord. And we can trust you, Lord. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you are pouring out your Spirit, Lord. And your sons and daughters will prophesy, Lord. Father, I thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your mercy and your grace, Lord. Father, I just say have your way in each life here today, Lord. That, Father, we can be confident in who you are, Lord. Father, you're good, good Father. And you care for each one of us. So, Father, I just say have your way, Lord. Have your way in Jesus' name.
Lord, help us to humble ourselves. Lord, help us to understand. You're showing us just how small we are. But Lord, at the same time, you're showing us just how big that you are. Lord, nothing is beyond your scope of control. Lord, this did not catch you by surprise. Father God, you were not alarmed. You didn't close heaven. Father, help us to fall on our knees and to seek you first, to seek you only in these uncertain times. God, in these times where we can't find hand sanitizer and we can't find toilet paper, Lord, may we know that we can find you every time we hit our knees, every time we bow our hearts, every time we open up our mouth to speak, you hear. Lord, we are not alone. You are with us. Anybody else like to pray?
Dear God, your word says, "Fear not, for I am with you, and you are right here with us today. You're blessing us in a special way, and we just give you all the glory. We thank you for this day, and we can assemble together to praise your holy name."
Father, we stand before you, we sit before you, we worship before you this day. Because, Lord, you were the beginning. You were present during the creation. And, Lord, you will be the end. You will be the end of time. You will be the end of the earth. But you will be the beginning of eternity. So, Lord, until that time, we're just going to live with the Prince of Peace. We're going to live with the Lion of Judah. The power and the strength that he gives us, and the peace and calmness during anything that comes across the earth, during any pandemic. There's no pandemic that is greater than you, God. There's no sickness that is greater than you. And there's no love that is greater than you. So Lord, we're just going to worship you. We're going to lift you on high. We are going to live in your love. We are not going to live in fear. Lord, we're going to live in peace and comfort. We are not going to live in chaos. Because, Lord, you are the center of our lives. You are the center of our worship. You are the center of your church. And we thank you for Jesus Christ, who has drawn us all together. And we are here today to worship you. And, Lord, when we leave here, we're going to let the fear right here. We're going to leave it at the altar. And we're going to walk out of here praising the name of Jesus in his security and safety each and every day. Thank you, Lord, that you're such a wonderful, awesome God. Amen.
fading, let mercy fall on thee. Everyone needs forgiveness, kindness of the Savior. The hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
Thank you. You're my joy, my rest.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for that powerful name of Jesus. Lord, we lift you up. We praise you. We lift our voices and our hearts and our eyes to look to you this morning, to speak to us from your word and from your heart. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. All right, you may be seated. At this time, the children are dismissed to children's church. We do have a few announcements. Some of the announcements you were reading on the page were done, or on the computer screen, were done before the band came down. So a lot of things have been canceled. Youth is meeting tonight at 6 o'clock. I do know that. Fellowship team is meeting tomorrow at 6 and board meeting at 7. I do know that. Bible study will probably meet this Wednesday, depending on what the board decides tomorrow night. So, but I imagine that Bible study will still meet Wednesday at 6. Bring a covered dish to share. The community Lenten services, at least for the next 2 weeks, have been canceled due to the population being overwhelmingly above 60 years old, and them getting together has been frowned upon. So for the next 2 weeks at least, they are canceled. Iron sharpens iron. Any word on that? No go. It is canceled. So the men's retreat has been canceled. Also, winter jam on the 28th has been canceled. So there will be no winter jam. Also, the Easter egg hunt and pizza party on April 5th after the church service, we'll talk about as a board, and the vision retreat in the beginning of April, we'll discuss. They are still planning to happen, but it's too early to determine whether they will happen or not. So, welcome to 2020. As many of you probably know, this year's theme for our church has been for the glory of the Lord. And I can think of nothing that we can do in trying times, nothing we can do in good times, that's more beneficial and more pleasing to God than to give Him glory, or to add to the glory that's being given to Him. After all, did you know that everything around you is already busy glorifying the Lord? That's its job. That's what the whole earth is doing before Him. Psalms 19 says this, the first four verses. It says, "The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of His hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the end of the world. In the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun." So even though we can't hear it and we can't comprehend what's going on, the world and the earth and the universe and everything in them is giving glory to God. And because of coronavirus, it has not stopped. The earth still continues to give God glory. The heavens still continue to give Him glory. They're still lifting it up because He is worthy. According to the scripture, the whole earth and the whole universe is busy on a daily basis giving glory to the Lord. So how does that work? Well, I want you to take a look at one of my favorite teaching clips on the subject that I've ever seen in my life.
He says, "Praise Him, sun and moon, and praise Him, all you shining stars." That's not just a poetic idea. That's really happening, because stars don't just shine. Stars also sing. Let me just show you a couple more stars. This one is called the Vela Pulsar, and it's magnificent. It's 1,000 light years away. It's a highly magnetized neutron star. Right. Simply means this star exploded into a supernova, and in the case of the Vela Pulsar, it collapsed back on itself in a magnetic entity. And as a pulsar, it began oscillating on its axis. This one oscillates 11 times a second on its axis. And as it is oscillating, you can see what's happening. It's shooting a radio frequency out of itself. When they aimed the radio telescopes at the Vela Pulsar, this is what they heard. And this is what this guy does 24/7, day and night, 365 days a year. This is what, from 1,000 light years away, the Vela pulsar sounds like right now. This is it. Listen to this. I don't know about you, but that blew me away. I'm thinking, wow, this is incredible. You're like, well, what does it mean? I don't know. Is that some kind of Morse code for something? Or what does all that mean? I don't know what it means, but and I don't want to, you know, go too crazy here, but maybe the Vela pulsar got wind somehow innately of Psalm 148, verse 3, and says, praise him, sun and moon and all you shining stars. We're a shining star. We should praise him. Well, how are we going to praise him? I know. Let's oscillate 11 times a second on our axis and see if we can send a radio signal into the universe that would join in the symphony of God's praise from all creation. It's singing. The stars are singing to him. I recently stumbled on 47 Tuck. It's a beautiful cluster of stars. I'll show you the picture of it here. There are 12 of these super giant blue stars in there, but the things that are of interest to us tonight are these millisecond pulsars. And right now, tonight, while we're sitting in this room, the 16 recorded millisecond pulsars at 47 Tuck are making this sound right now. Sea creatures in all deeps. The whale songs could sound like this right here. Take a listen. We don't know the expanse of the worship that is continually surrounding the throne of God. And our songs are great, but God isn't banking on our songs because he is surrounded by a symphony that's bigger than our wildest dreams tonight. Stars sing and whales sing and the birds fly. And I just tried to imagine what would it sound like if you could just for a second be God and hear what he hears. And I can't get us there tonight, but I came close. I had a friend who helped me with this little iPad program. And I'm not a DJ, but just a little thing, just quickly. And I want you to see how this works. This guy, we didn't look at his picture. He's PSR BO329-54. And he's only rotating 1.5 times per second, which is not all that much, but we need him in our little experiment we're going to do here, okay? And then we had the Vela pulsar. You remember the Vela pulsar, right? So that's that guy. That's a little too fast for what we're trying to do, so we're going to slow that down, okay? Just heard, here they come. this, and you just got to know this is unedited. We just dropped this on. This is what happened. This is what they might be singing.
Is to give God glory in everything that we do, everything that we say, everything that we think. Our job is to join in the chorus that's already taken place, whether you can see it or hear it or know about it. It's already happening, and it's your choice whether to join in to declare His greatness. You know, according to the shorter Westminster Catechism, the very first thing in it says the chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. Do you believe that? That the chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. This is tied up in our being and in our essence as His creation. We have an innate desire within us to proclaim with the world all around us how great is our God. You know, Paul wanted to remind the church in Corinth about this as he wrote the final words down to chapter 10. So let's turn there or follow along on the screen on 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 23, and we're going to read through chapter 11, verse 1. This is what Paul says. He says, "I have the right to do anything, you say, but not everything is beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but not everything is constructive. No one should seek their own good, but the good of others. Eat anything sold in the meat market without raising questions of conscience, for the earth is the Lord and everything in it. And if an unbeliever invites you to a meal and you want to go, eat whatever is put before you without raising questions of conscience. But if someone says to you, 'This has been offered in sacrifice,' then do not eat it, both for the sake of the one who told you and for the sake of the conscience. I am referring to the other person's conscience, not yours. For why is my freedom being judged by another's conscience? If I take part in the meal with thankfulness, why am I denounced because of something I thank God for? So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Do not cause anyone to stumble, whether Jews, Greek, or the church of God, even as I tried to please everyone in every way. For I'm not seeking my own good, but the good of many, so that they may be saved. This is the important part. Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. You know, just like this passage of Scripture, so many times we get caught up in the insignificant things of life. It's like, hey, Paul, can I eat that? That was the question he got asked all the time. Hey, Paul, can I eat that? Can I eat this? Can I drink this? And Paul must have, over and over and over and over, I don't know how he survived. Paul, can I eat this? Can I do this? Paul, can I do this? Paul simply states, listen, maybe we're not asking the right questions. Instead, Paul says, do everything, everything you eat, everything you drink, everything you do for the glory of God. Don't get caught up in a squabble, a difference of opinion, a question of whether this thing is right or this thing is right. And that's not the important question we should be asking. The most important question we can ask ourselves is this: am I contributing to the glory of the Lord? Am I contributing to the glory of the Lord? Before we go any further, let's ask the Lord to bless our time this morning. Father God, help us to understand and comprehend your word today. And Lord, help us to understand what it means to give you glory in all things, in all that we say and do and eat. Father God, may you be glorified in it all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the first thing that I see in here when I look through the scripture is that as a Christian, we shouldn't settle for good when we can be glorious. We shouldn't settle for being good when we can be glorious. You know, for my entire life in ministry, which is over 20 years now, and that's hard to believe, but all people who have followed the faith, whatever age group, they always have questions of the pastor. Pastor, is it okay if we do this? Or pastor, when I dealt with the college students, pastor, how far can I go with my significant other before it's considered sin? They wanted to know. When I taught with high school students, they wanted to know things like, is it okay for me to drink or do this or do that? And when I dealt with adults, it mostly switched to, pastor, do you think it's okay to play the lottery? Or can I have a drink once in a while? And all of these are questions, and they're inquisitive, and we want to know. Lots of people will draw lots of lines, and it will cause lots of fights and lots of disagreements in churches even. So where do you draw the line? But that's not the appropriate question. And Paul addresses this right off the bat here in Scripture. Paul says this in verse 23. It says, I have the right to do anything, you say, but not everything is beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but not everything is constructive. No one should seek their own good, but the good of others. So when we ask the question, where do I draw the line? Perhaps Paul would contend that we're not even asking the right question. Instead of asking, where do I draw the line? And even asking, where does God draw the line? We should ask, will this activity give God glory? Period. That's the question we should be asking ourselves. If I partake in this, or I do this, and or I go this route, will this activity bring more glory to God? As a believer, do you have the right to do anything? Yes. As a believer, do you have the freedom to do certain things? Yes. But what Paul is saying is, don't use your rights, don't use your freedoms to walk over other people. Don't claim your rights. Don't claim your benefits unless it's bringing God glory and bringing other people to Him. As a believer, you have the freedom to do certain things, but we cannot allow these things to get in the way of other people of constructing the body of believers as a whole. We need to lift the Lord up by lifting up others. We need to lift the Lord up by living out the word He has given us, by loving our neighbors. We need to show off the glory of the Lord in the way that we treat other people around you, because it's not about us. It's about God and who He is.
Amen.
We need to look not only to our own interests, but to the interests of others, and whether what we are claiming we want to do or have the right to do will glorify the Lord. So instead of asking, where do I draw the line? We need to instead ask, will this activity bring God glory? Second thing that I see in this scripture is that we're not, as Christians, we're not to major in the minors when we can major in the major. When I say the name Jim Rohn, how many of you have heard that name? Jim Rohn, R-O-H-N. Oh good, this works better with nobody putting their hands up. But if you look up his name on Wikipedia, you will find he's described as a farmer, an entrepreneur, an author, and a motivational speaker. He found some success as an entrepreneur, but even that, half of his businesses ended up failing or going out of business. Not a very good track record, huh? And as a result of his last business going under, he became a motivational speaker and a mentor. Now listen to this list. Here's his partial list of mentees. Mark Hughes, the founder of Herbalife. Anybody heard of Herbalife or bought any of their products? He mentored their founder. Mark Victor Hansen and Jack Canfield both sat under him. You know those names? They are the creators of the Chicken Soup for the Soul book series. How about motivational speaker Tony Robbins? You've heard of that one. All of these people sat under the teaching of Jim Rohn. And his most famous quote that he used with every one of them was this: learn how to separate the majors and the minors. A lot of people don't do well simply because they major in the minor things. That's solid advice. And it's helped so many people to not make a mountain out of a molehill. You know what that is, right? Making a mountain out of a molehill. Letting 5 minutes of a conversation ruin your entire day. Making a mountain out of a molehill. But many times as Christians, we are guilty of what Rome was talking about. We focus on the minor things of the faith instead of dealing with the most important thing. We make a big deal about what should be a small deal. We major in the minors, and then we have no time or energy to spend on the things that matters most. Here's what Paul says on it in the book of, in our scripture in Corinthians. He says, starting in verse 25, eat anything sold in the meat market without raising questions of conscience, for the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. If an unbeliever invites you to a meal and you want to go, eat whatever is put before you without raising questions of conscience. But if someone says to you, this has been offered in sacrifice, then do not eat it, both for the sake of the one who told you and for the sake of conscience. I am referring to the other person's conscience, not yours. For why is my freedom being judged by another's conscience? If I take part in the meal with thankfulness, why am I denounced because of something I thank God for? So then we get to the important part. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. So what Paul was saying is all of this stuff you're asking me about, we can, if you want to focus on there, we'll do it. But this is all minor stuff. This is all insignificant stuff. The major thing is giving God glory. Giving God glory. You know, it seemed like a major deal in the Corinthian church to talk about whether you can eat this or drink this. And how did Paul respond? He responded by saying, whatever you eat, whatever you drink, and then he added, whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Paul was trying to convince the church at Corinth to major in the majors. The food sacrifice to idols, that's a good cause. It's a major concern. But isn't it more disconcerting that God wasn't getting the glory in their life? This is where our focus to be. It is at all times and all things. Don't get bogged down in trivial debates, lesser issues, and superficial things. Make sure God is getting the glory. So what's it look like when we major in the minors in today's church? I thought of a few things. When we get up and when we get caught up in the kinds of songs that we sing in worship instead of worshiping God, that's majoring in the minors. When we get caught up making decisions based on the bottom line of the budget instead of what God wants and will give Him glory, that's majoring in the minors. When we get focused on the color of the carpet and what if the right cloth is on the communion table and if things are just as they should be instead of as God getting glory, that's majoring in the minors. Paul was saying, major in the major. To do that, we have to give God glory in all things. And you know what? These other things, when we do our part and give God glory, these other things will all fall into place. I guarantee it. Give God glory. Be God's glory to other people. And point people to His glory. That's what we need to be about. And finally, the last thing that I see in this scripture is that as Christians, we don't follow our heart. We follow the leader. How many of you have been given the advice to follow your heart? About the worst piece of advice you can be given. Biblically, it's the worst piece of advice that you can give someone. What does the Word tell us? The Word tells us that the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Wait, what? The heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. That's what the Word says about our heart. So if you're telling me to follow my heart, you're telling me to follow something deceitful that can't be fixed. It's terrible advice. But here's what Paul says. Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. Not follow your heart, follow my heart. Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. Following the example of Christ, that's where our eyes should be. That's where our feet should go. And you know what? This will always receive or point others to give God glory, and will always lead to God getting glory in our lives. Jesus became flesh and dwelt among us. He was the glory of God in human form. And Jesus never did His own bidding, but only the bidding of the Father. In fact, Jesus went on to make the statement that anyone who has seen Him has seen the Father. So here's Paul saying, Paul says, follow my example, because I follow the example of Jesus. And here's Jesus saying, follow my example, because I follow the example of the Father. We must make it our aim to follow Jesus. Your heart will lie to you. Your friends can't always be trusted. The media will tell you to fear and overreact to every little thing. But you will find your strength when you follow Jesus in every way. That's what Jesus wants. That's why He went to fishermen and said what? Follow me. Didn't ask them if their theology agreed with his. Didn't ask them if they thought he was a good guy and to come along beside. He said, follow me. Only Jesus knows how to be the glory of God on this earth, so we need to follow His example. So if the entire earth, the entire universe is busy giving glory to the Lord, what should we be doing? According to 2 Corinthians 3:18, it says this, and we all who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory are being transformed into His image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is in the Spirit. Let me read that again. And we all, Christians, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory. So we're thinking about the Lord's glory, but as Christians, we are being transformed into His image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. We need to be adding to the glory of the Lord, because that's what we're created to do. So how do we add to it? We add to it by allowing the glory of God to transform us into His glorious image. I want you to turn to your neighbor and tell them that you are a glorious Christian. I don't think you believe it. The problem is that we don't often feel glorious. Amen? But there's your heart again lying to you. Because the Word says that you are being transformed into His image with ever-increasing glory, meaning it's adding more glory as the days go on. So that later this afternoon, Sharon, you're going to be more glorious than you were before you came here this morning. Amen? And Alan, you're going to be more glorious than you were yesterday. I don't know if we can handle tomorrow's Alan, but today's Alan is here. But tomorrow's Alan is going to be more glorious. That is the absolute truth, that when you dwell in the glory of the Lord, you become more glorious day after day. So we don't often think that we're adding to the chorus of glory that is being lifted up to God, but that's our feelings. That's our feelings. That's our thoughts. The absolute truth is this. When you give God glory, you become a part of the song that is lifting Him up, and you become more glorious as well. This is what you were made for. You were made to give God glory.
Amen.
And if you're not doing that, then you will feel worthless and your life will lack meaning. I can guarantee it. You were made to join in with the everlasting song being lifted up by the stars and the galaxies and the whales and the trees and whatever else chooses to sing. You were made to be transformed by His glory to add to the glory that He already has. Would you pray with me? Lord, I thank You for Your word. And Lord, even in a time like this, You are glorious. You are beyond compare. And Lord, we need to be thinking about how we can give You glory, because You are worthy to receive all glory. Lord, the stars, they're already singing. The whales are already lifting up their voices, telling the world how glorious that You are. And it's up to us to choose whether to join them or not to join them. Lord, help us to realize that the most important thing that we can do is to give You glory, to lift You up, to praise Your name, to show others how glorious You are. May we be all about Your glory in the coming days and weeks. Because the world has no glory to offer. It has doom and gloom, toilet paper shortages, and fear and panic. You have glory to offer. May we tell You about Your glory, and may we tell others about it as well. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Let's go ahead and stand.
the splendor of the King. Oh, the majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing to me, how great is our God. Oh, see, how great. How great is our God. Age to age.
Inserted yourself into a situation where everything around you is giving God glory. The trees are doing it. The waves are doing it. The animals are doing it. They all got the memo to give God glory. Sometimes we forget. That's our job. That's what we were put here to do. And if you want to be at home and feel closer to God at more times than just in these moments, that's what you need to be doing. Giving God the glory He deserves. So go be glorious today.
Amen.
And stay away from people, so they say. You are dismissed.